Throughout history, a woman's place in most societies was determined by oppressive social norms, economic barriers, and restrictive legislation. Women were denied the opportunity to develop their full potential. From the arrival of Europeans to the land we now call Canada, Native, French, British, and Black women have lived similar lives. The expulsion in 1755 and religious restrictions gave Acadian women a much harder time. Until the late 19th century, English common law allowed husbands to beat their wives if they disobeyed them. When the first election took place in New Brunswick in 1785, women, natives, Catholics, and blacks had no voice in the formation of their first government. All these inequalities created a breeding ground for change. Women and their male supporters challenged and fought many battles for women to gain their social and economic freedom. The following stories celebrate these women. When Françoise Jacqueline sailed away from La Rochelle, France, to Acadia to be the wife of Charles Saint-Étienne de La Tour, she had no idea what the future would bring to her. Shortly after her arrival, Françoise realized that Charles La Tour, the governor of Acadia, had rivals. Seigneur D'Aulny was the most threatening one.
At one time, when her husband was in Boston seeking aid, rival D'Aulny came and attacked Charles Latour's fort. Now, his wife was there in charge as the commandant, and she had about 49 or 50 men with her. And they fought off D'Aulny with his big ships and his cannon for 3 days and nights until finally they had to surrender. And he had promised to give everybody quarter to spare them.
But D'Aulny changed his mind. He not only killed all the men, but also made her watch the slaughter. Shortly after, Françoise died. But her bravery assured the place of this woman in history as an Acadian heroine. With the arrival of loyalists, black slave women appeared in New Brunswick. Slaves were the legal property of their masters. They were bought and sold at auctions as a commodity. They were shackled, whipped, and raped by their masters. They often tried to escape from their owners. In 1799, a slave woman named Nancy lived in Fredericton. Her owner was the notorious Caleb Jones. Nancy found an opportunity and ran away. Slave catchers were after her, and warnings in the newspaper made it impossible for free blacks to harbor her. She was caught and imprisoned. But two abolitionist lawyers, Ward Chipman and Samuel Street, helped Nancy to claim her freedom before the Supreme Court of New Brunswick.
Three of the four judges of that court were slave owners themselves. Judge Saunders was the only opponent of slavery on that bench. Nancy divided the Supreme Court on the issue of slavery. Although no decision was made and she was returned to her master, and just imagine her agony at that, her case had an enormous impact on the ownership of slavery in New Brunswick.
For centuries, religion played a dual role in women's lives. It gave women a place of spiritual refuge for themselves and also a sense of power in serving others. Honoria Conway immigrated to New Brunswick from Ireland with her family in 1837. For many years as a young woman, Honoria helped suffering Irish children, victims of the cholera epidemic. At age 37, she decided to be a nun and joined the Sisters of Charity in New York. While she was in training, Bishop Connolly of St. John appealed to the sisters. He asked the nuns to take care of the orphaned children. Honoria and three other sisters volunteered, and they formed the Sisters of Charity in St. John, where Honoria continued to take care of the orphans until her death in 1892. In 1924, under the leadership of Susanna Sear of Madawaska, 53 members broke away from the order and established the Notre Dame du Sacré-Cœur of Moncton to serve and assist Acadians in maintaining their faith, culture, and language. The lack of higher education was a great obstacle for women in their struggle for equality, as training schools and universities were exclusively for men. But in 1849, Martha Ham Lewis became the first woman to challenge and break the pattern. She obtained an order from the Lieutenant Governor, Edmund Head, to attend normal school and train as a teacher. The school had no choice but to accept Martha, but it set certain conditions. Martha was to be veiled at all times, had to enter the class earlier than the boys, sit at the back of the classroom, was not to talk with anybody. These restrictions did not affect Martha at all. In the end, she earned the title of the first licensed female teacher in New Brunswick. Alice Davis Hart, an upper-class British-born Jewish woman, emigrated to St. John with her husband in 1858. For years, she devoted herself to her children until they did not need her support.
In 1896, she organized the ladies to form actually the first Jewish women's organization in St. John, the Daughters of Israel.
Alice was a religious woman. She taught Hebrew to the children. She raised money to construct a mikvah, the ritual bath for the spiritual cleansing of women. Her ability to meet the needs of community made a tremendous impact on her tiny Jewish community in St. John. In the 1870s, while teaching in a public school in Norton, Elizabeth Smith met and married John Secord. At the age of 32, she was left a widow with a young child. Elizabeth then decided to become a medical doctor. She enrolled at the College of Keokuk in Iowa, the only co-ed medical college in North America at the time. After her graduation in 1881, she did her internship at the Women's College Hospital in Dublin, Ireland. On her return to New Brunswick in 1883, Elizabeth, despite bitter opposition, was registered as the first female physician in New Brunswick. She practiced medicine for 23 years until her death in 1916. Emily LeBlanc was born in 1863 in Memramcook and grew up in an era that accorded little importance to women's rights. Her studies with a religious order and at the normal school gave her the necessary tools to express her daring ideas. While teaching in Nova Scotia, Emily found a way to present her ideas in the Acadian newspaper L'Evangeline. She wrote 13 letters between 1895 and 1898 under the pseudonym Marie Chette. Emily chose to write her letters in dialect, which made them very popular among the Acadian women. Her first letter demanded the right to vote for women.
I want a right to tell you that I'm sick and tired of waiting for the House to pass the law on suffrage for women to give us the right to vote. Right now, women are suffering with the yearning to go to the polls to show the old codgers how to vote.
Emily knew the power of knowledge and used her pen to empower Acadian women. In the late 1890s, Mary Matilda Winslow, a young black woman, made her mark as the smartest student at the college school in Woodstock. This articulate and intelligent young woman received the highest marks in matriculation and then enrolled at the University of New Brunswick in 1901. In 1905, Matilda once again graduated with the highest marks and became the first black woman to graduate from a New Brunswick university. Although justice is symbolized by a woman, social attitudes and English common law prevented women from entering the legal profession. Mabel French was the first woman to challenge this. After graduating from the King's College School of Law, she applied for admission to the bar. But the Barristers' Society of New Brunswick referred her application to the Supreme Court of New Brunswick because under the law, she was not a person, and therefore she could not practice law. The Supreme Court of New Brunswick refused to hear her case for the same reason. She was not a person. Her case then came to the attention of Attorney General William Pugsley. He was furious. He introduced a bill in the legislature to remove the barriers preventing women from practicing law. In 1906, after months of legal jousting, Mabel French was admitted to the bar and became the first practicing female lawyer in New Brunswick. After decades of struggle with the political establishment, in 1919, Canadian women got what they wanted, the right to elect and be elected in federal elections. Minnie Bell Adney of Woodstock was the first New Brunswick woman to file nomination papers for the 1919 federal election. A graduate of the New York Music Academy, Minnie Bell was a well-known music teacher, a successful businesswoman, and a horticulturalist. She declared her intention to run in the Carleton Sentinel newspaper and wrote a short bibliography about herself.
When 4 years old, I had my life planned out, what I would do and be. I always had unlimited faith in my power for great achievement. No height seemed impossible for me to overcome.
Despite her intentions and successful background, Minnie Bell's name never appeared on the ballot. It is said that her solicitors were bribed to ensure her nomination papers were lost. Nevertheless, the history of New Brunswick recognizes Minnie Bell for her courageous attempt to run for political office. Like this little girl, minerals and rocks were always very special for the quiet and shy Helen Bellier. In 1931, Helen was the only female geology student at Dalhousie University in Halifax. She had an appetite for studying and wanted to advance in her field. And she did. Her doctoral degree on the Devonian rocks brought her international recognition. During the Second World War, Helen joined the Canadian Navy. In 1950, she, with another geologist, started the Calgary branch of the Geological Survey of Canada, where she remained for the rest of her life. She often did her fieldwork on horseback, collecting rock samples over rugged terrain. No mountain was too big for this intelligent woman to overcome. During her lifetime, Helen received prestigious medals, honorary degrees, fellowships, and became an officer of the Order of Canada. Economic uncertainty, an unpredictable job market, and corporate indifference created an atmosphere in which workers kept silent. Mathilde Blanchard of Caraquet, a middle-class businesswoman, was willing to challenge that.
And when I first started in 1965 or 6, they had this labor union, which they called the Fish Handlers Union of New Brunswick. Their contract was in English and everything. So when they started getting me little by little, you know, come to a meeting, get into another local. And then we couldn't do anything with this union because it was controlled by the company. And at certain of the meeting I went, well, they said that they had to ask this priest, was at every meeting they had. They called him the aumônier. They said the bishop had named him. So when I got in there and I wanted to do a real fight, you know, I said, look, you have to choose between me and Father Laviolette, because I'm not coming to a meeting where he's going to tell you that, you know, little infant Jesus was born in a poor place, and then that you have to be like that. So finally, there was a big discussion about it. I mean, the workers, there was one side, the other. And finally, they said, okay, we'll try you. They never got rid of me after that.
A woman representing more than 3,000 workers fighting against the big companies was unheard of in those years. Matilda loved it. To make more progressive changes, she ran for the leadership of the Conservative Party of New Brunswick. But it was her daughter Louise Blanchard who could claim the title of the first female leader of a political party in New Brunswick, the Parti Acadien. Matilda's fight against political, social, and economic injustice earned her the prestigious Saint-Jean-Baptiste Medal in 1988. For generations, only male crews and captains sailed the treacherous waters of the Bay of Fundy. But Captain Paul Cool of Alma was different. In the 1930s, he often took his daughter Molly along.
When I came through school, it was in depression. There were no jobs. But my father needed a seaman and I needed a job. So I went to sea because of this. And the fact that I was ambitious, I did want to do something that I could earn a living. I went to the navigation school in St. John. And in the spring, I wrote for a mate's license and passed.
But a mate's certificate was not enough for Molly. She wanted to be a captain.
I went to school in Yarmouth. I was still the only woman in the class. But when it came time for me to write for my master's license, they held me up for a couple of weeks until they could put she in the Canada Shipping Act. And I did pass. And when I knew this, I sent my sister a telegram saying, call me captain from now on.
As the first female captain in North America and the second in the world, Molly took over her father's ship and skipped through fog, winds, and storms for years. In 1992, the village of Alma paid homage to Molly by erecting a cairn in her honor. Marion Upton of Minto was another young, independent-minded woman who was in the process of making history. In 1919, she was working shoulder to shoulder with men, managing a large coal mine office. Marion was a woman ahead of her time. She loved to fish and hunt. She was also very much involved in volunteering.
She was a very strong-minded lady, and her motto was, either put up or shut up, which tells it all, I guess.
At 77, an age when most women would prefer to have a quiet life, Marion ran as the only female candidate for mayor of Minto. The people of Minto chose Marion over the other candidates, and in 1967, she became the first elected female mayor in New Brunswick. 1967 was also an important year for Brenda Robertson. She ran for the Progressive Conservative Party and became the first woman to be elected to the New Brunswick legislature. Her arrival at the legislature made some ripples on a relatively calm political and social sea. In 1970, Brenda became the first female cabinet minister.
Men mostly in those days, especially I'd say about half of the cabinet, really didn't know what to do with me. They treated me strictly, or tried to treat me strictly, as a female who didn't know anything. and wasn't supposed to know anything about public life. I found that interesting, you know, I really did. I can remember we were discussing, I talked with the Premier, Premier Hatfield at one point, about the requirement. I just felt very strongly that we had to have some deputy ministers in the government that were female. And I had a couple of very good recommendations, and he agreed with me. And when it was brought up with my colleagues, I can remember, to this day, very clearly, one gentleman said, "But men won't work for a woman." You know, and here I was, the minister of the largest department in the government, and I was doing fine, thank you. But it was hard to get past a certain mental block with some of them.
Brenda's entrance into politics encouraged many other women to follow her path and change the political face of the New Brunswick legislature. Colonization destroyed the more egalitarian system of native life and forced the natives to accept European culture and language. In the 1930s, Margaret Labillois of Eel River Band Reserve near Dalhousie was a young girl.
When I went to school here at the Indian Day School, it was run by the Catholic, the church. We were not allowed to speak Mi'kmaq at all. I didn't know that we had a religion of our own or our own governments or anything else. You know, we always thought we were a part of the rest of the society, which I guess they want us to believe, you know.
Margaret and her friends were often punished for speaking their language. Those harsh rules made an impact on Margaret. She wanted to bring back native values.
We're not allowed to gather, not even gather or to do any ceremonies or any gatherings of dancing. Those things were gone forever, I might as well say, you know. And that is why it was very important for me as a Native person, as a Mi'kmaq, to try and regain some of those things that have been lost. Because that's who we are, you know. We can't be anybody else. You know, no matter how white they want us to be, we're not white, you know. We're not. We're the color of Mother Earth, you know. That's our identity.
This humble woman worked diligently for many years for her cause. She earned the respect of both the native and non-native people. In 1970, Margaret became the first elected female chief of the First Nations of New Brunswick. And in 1998, she was awarded the Order of Canada. The Imperial Theatre was a place that Pamela Coates could never afford to go in her life until she gave a speech upon receiving her honorary degree from the University of New Brunswick.
It was a most amazing event for me. I was a taxi driver, I cleaned windows, I've done a number of jobs in the city. I've been a closet drinker, and now here I am on Imperial Theatre receiving an honor degree, but also giving the speech.
But it took Pamela many unpleasant years to reach this amazing moment.
I was in an abusive marriage, and so I stayed in that marriage for 15 years. In 1982, I had the birth of my son, Kenny, and I was determined that he wasn't going to grow up with an alcoholic mother or father, for that matter, in an abusive home. So I guess that's the year that I started looking for counseling and for help.
Pamela sought counseling, where she and other women often talked about injustice in society. Her son gave Pamela the power and motivation to achieve her goals. To support the poor, she formed the North End Food Bank. In 1998, she, as the president of the National Anti-Poverty Organization, represented Canada at the United Nations Conference in Geneva.
Yes. Violence and poverty.
In 2001, Pamela still lives in St. John and continues her fight as an anti-poverty activist.
Somewhere at this moment,
For more than 300 years, New Brunswick women have challenged, disrupted, and changed many prevailing social attitudes, from race to religion to politics. Although they have had considerable success, the struggle is not over yet. There is still a great need for New Brunswick women and men to face the challenges of today's society and continue to fight the battles these pioneer women began.